Welcome to Temple University Japan campus. Just a few house cleaning things before we start. If you haven't done so yet, put your phone on vibrate only. If you didn't get an invitation from us, don't forget to give us your business card, or you can either give it to me. I'm Robert Dujarric. I'm the chief butler at ICAS. And we have a box over there that takes business cards. And also, we always strongly encourage you to make donations, because these programs are free, unlike many things in Tokyo, but they're not necessarily cost-free. So we thank you all for coming. I don't believe in long introductions, because brevity is a sort of wit. So I just say we're extremely happy to have Grant Newsham, who is a very distinguished career as a Japan expert, as a Marine Corps officer. He was actively involved in the rescue effort after the 2011 tsunami earthquake. He was one, I think, of the first American officers to arrive in Sendai.
Mm-hmm. It was one of them. He was one of the first.
Okay. He's a well-known commentator on foreign affairs and Asian security issues. So I put the link on the invitation for his national interest piece, How to Get Tough with China, which has a very nice photograph of President Obama and the Secretary General of the party, Xi, drinking something. I don't know whether it was taken in Washington or in Beijing. So I'm going to kind of start to interrogate him, to ask him a few questions, and then we'll open this for Q&A for the audience. So thanks again, Grant.
Sure. We're
very happy to have you as one of our repeat participants at our events. So one thing you say, as you put it, that China is trying to build a greater South China Sea co-prosperity sphere. That's the term you describe, and you believe that China is trying to establish at minimum regional hegemony in the region. Do you think that's really the case? Why do you think that's happening?
I would say one of the main reasons I think so is because China said so. One of the curious aspects, or an interesting aspect, of the current situation in East Asia, in South China Sea in particular, is that the Chinese have been very clear what they've intended to do since at least 1992. But on the U.S. side, you find the American foreign policy community, a lot of the government, just chose not to believe them. There's always been a lot of fuss and fretting about China being transparent or telling us what their intentions are. But China's been very clear. They've made it very clear that the South China Sea is their territory, and that the United States really, it will only be in the region at China's sufferance. And it's taken 20 plus years, but they've gotten where they said they wanted to go.
And one thing you call for is that the US should clearly state that it too has core interests, mm-hmm. to use a Chinese phrase. What are these core interests for the US in the region? And which ones are being threatened by the PRC?
Well, particularly the notion, there's a couple notions, things that are particularly important. And one is the idea that certain parts of the region belong to everybody. And these are established boundaries, these are customary behaviors, and that it isn't right for one country, particularly a big one, to decide it wants to take something or dominate it because it wants it. And this is a principle which goes well beyond Asia. You can see it in Europe with Putin and Crimea, Ukraine. Once you start rearranging boundaries in this area, it can happen in all sorts of places, and nothing good tends to come of that. There's also a notion that big countries and small countries have equal rights. And this is the fundamental idea behind the United Nations, for example. And that the idea that, well, a big country can do what it wants to a little one is something that is against America's core values, core interests. And I would suggest it's against the international community, the civilized community's interests. There was that telling statement by a Chinese official a couple of years ago where in some exasperation after he was challenged on his position, he says something, well, you're just a crappy little country, or words to that effect. And that gave an insight into China's view of things too often. And it is something that America needs to defend, is this idea that small countries have the same rights as big ones, and the idea, once again, of the sanctity of boundaries, and particularly in the East Asia and the South China Sea, that the freedom of navigation, that these seas being open, is an important principle to uphold.
What about the U.S. invasion of Iraq in 2003?
That one you can argue either way. What I would suggest is that the fact that you have the United States is not perfect does not mean it isn't on the right track. Certainly it makes mistakes, every country does. But you notice that America didn't stay in Iraq. They didn't go in saying, well, we want to keep it. We didn't say, well, an American was in Iraq 150 years ago, therefore it's our territory. Plus it has a lot of oil. America got there and wanted to get out as fast as it could. Unfortunately, it had a lot of trouble getting out. So once again, this, I think, is qualitatively very different than China, for example, claiming an ocean half again as big as the Mediterranean as its territory. If America were to say, if we'd gone to Iraq and said, well, this is going to be the 51st state, then I think you'd be a more apt comparison.
Is it just the South China Sea, or where else? Where do you consider that China's claims are an issue? I mean, you've South China Sea, East China Sea, Taiwan.
Well, I think the most important one. The Indians would certainly tell you they've got problems, and they've had them since the 60s, if not earlier. But I think for now the main focal point is the South China Sea. However, the East China Sea's turn is coming. And at some point that you will find Chinese pressure in the East China Sea again. And once again, China's been very clear, you know, what belongs to them. And they have said that the Ryukyus, the Nansei Shoto, are Chinese. But what we just choose not to believe them. So South China Sea for now, but East China Sea's turn is coming. And every now and then it gets attention from the Chinese just to give a taste of what they've got in mind.
Now, if you move from this to how we implement a new U.S. Policy slash strategy or grand strategy, you call for, as you put it, clarify and strengthen U.S.-Japan bonds. I think I took my first class on Japanese politics with Reischauer in 1979, and I think this was already something that was being mentioned. What really is Japan doing now that it wasn't doing 10 years ago? In other words, can the U.S. reasonably expect Japan to do more? I mean, Prime Minister Abe passed the new security legislation at an enormous political cost. I mean, he lost at one point like 20 points in terms of popularity. The new security legislation basically allows Japan to be like the Vatican. Vatican has an army. It has the right to defend itself. I mean, there's nothing. I mean, if you read this, you have to live on another planet to think that it was a militaristic piece of legislation. Mm-hmm. I mean, it says, if we attack, we have the right to consider the possibility of maybe using force, and we have the right to have allies. I mean, this is not, on a scale from 0 to 10, it's 0.01. And even that was difficult. Defense spending is not going up. There's no political market for this. What else can the U.S. get Japan to do to strengthen the alliance reasonably?
Mm-hmm. There's a few things that it can do. One of them is to, I say, better integrate U.S. and Japanese forces. A good example of what's already being done pretty well is the U.S. Navy and the Japanese Navy have actually got a pretty good, a very good operational relationship. The other services do not. And this is something that could easily be done, but it requires just a commitment on both sides to do it. And that would be immensely useful. because the Japan has got a good military, but it has some problems, particularly in something that could be corrected and would be very helpful, is to get the Japanese Air Self-Defense Force, the Ground Self-Defense Force, and the Maritime Self-Defense Force able to actually operate together. That's a really an unrecognized problem, or not, that whilst you have good individual services, they're pretty much incapable of operating in unison in any useful way. And that needs to be corrected. And the expression is called jointness. So if the JSDF actually gets some joint capability, you would find that would exponentially improve its capability. But linking a joint JSDF with US forces better, and I would say half jokingly, the way the US used to be with the British before the British decided they didn't want a military, that would be a pretty good example of where you could go. But also point out that there's a lot of the JSDF's problems track back to not having enough money. And the Japanese defense budget is just too small. Japan, for too many decades, got used to not spending much on defense and leaving it up to the Americans. And as a result, you have something that's the equivalent of an underfunded pension plan. And it's time to make some contributions to it. How much is necessary? About a 10% increase for 5 years. But the
10% every 5 years?
Every year. About that, every 5 years would take.
So to bring it to 1.6 of GDP.
Mm-hmm. So around that. And then that would go a long way. And it would be important not to spend it on hardware, because you can blow any amount of money on hardware. And the industry will be glad to blow it for you. But I would apply it to actually the conditioned, living conditions of the jiaitai. Of the servicemen, service women. So if you go onto a Japanese base, it's actually embarrassing just how boroi, how tattered things are. But they just need to spend more money. That would be something that would be very good to do. The Japanese will tell you that nowhere in their budget do they have 5 cents. That clearly is not true.
But as a politician, I mean, I've got to get the diet to, in the end, the voters have to decide because Japan is democracy. Is there a political market for this? I mean, can I get elected as a member of the Diet saying my goal is to increase defense by 10% while...
You know, I think you could, actually. And one thing, it's an observation that I've noticed is that the Japanese public has a view of defense and Japan, the threats facing Japan, which is very different than the views in Nagatacho, in the Diet. For example, you will see that when public opinion polls are done, and this goes back a while, and the question is asked to the effect, you know, do you have a good feeling about China? Do you see China as a threat? And the answer is invariably about 90% is, no, we don't have a good feeling about China. And I think if you ask the question in the Diet, you'd probably be hard-pressed to find 30%. There's some reasons for that. But so I think actually that the public at large has a pretty good understanding of Japan's national security requirements if the case is made, if it's explained to them. That's been my observation.
And you go back, now you mentioned that the ideal would be sort of Anglo-American relationship, as you put it, in the quote-unquote old days. But no, even today, for example, there are, I believe, Royal Air Force personnel that fly that are on U.S. Navy P-8 maritime patrol aircraft. I think if you go to 7th Fleet headquarters, you will see Australian officers. I was looking at a picture of, I think it's called Conquest, the multinational exercise takes place in Mongolia, and you saw the photograph of the operations officer of the American unit, and he was an Australian officer. You know, there are American pilots who fly off French aircraft carriers. You have that sort. Japan, my impression, is nowhere near this.
It'll take some time because looking back 10 years, you know, it was practically taboo for any Japanese officer to propose these things. He'd have been savaged by the Asahi Shimbun in short order and out of a job in a week. But things are different, and you do find the JSDF is doing a lot more in the region. And the Japanese Navy's always done a fair amount. But the opportunities have just gotten better as there's more of a recognition of the threat and just the basic idea that it's a normal thing for Japan to have more defense relationships throughout the region. I would point to Japan's new developing amphibious force. Well, there's no reason you couldn't put Japan's new amphibious force and work it in with Australia's new amphibious force, with 7th Fleet, with the U.S. Navy in the mix, and have them sail about doing things. But it just the things are moving in the right direction. The question is, how fast is it going? I'm actually fairly optimistic in that regard. But once again, it's taken a long time to get to this point.
Just a few more questions, because we opened to questions. You mentioned that Japan should really enhance its relationship with Taiwan, its military relationship. You say that the U.S. might even push Japan to sell its older subs to Taiwan. My understanding is that actually the Japanese Navy retires its subs when they're still in fairly good order. I mean, it's a little like cars. They don't keep them until they become dysfunctional. Do you think there'd be support for this in Japan? And how do you see the Taiwan-Japan relationship? Because that's something that's under-researched, I think.
I think what I've proposed would be considered sort of cutting, be considered a little bit revolutionary. But I think that the idea of more support for Japan, for Taiwan, I think that is a reasonable thing to suggest. And it really, even just the psychological support, the political support, and doing things as simple as the United States sending somebody of some prominence to the recent inauguration of the new president would be very helpful. Selling Taiwan some of this equipment that they've requested, that's a requirement. And I think that is something that should be done to live up to the terms of the Taiwan Relation Act. But one aspect of Taiwan that I think is, to me, very interesting, and that I think makes it really worth supporting Taiwan, as we have promised to do, and to the extent Japan can do it, have Japan do it, is the really how it's funny, because I heard in some Chinese scholars came to America, and I remember them explaining that, look, China has to be sort of oppressive. They have to be tough on their people, just to keep order. There's a billion people, but what they said is, just give us some time, and we'll improve. Just give us some time, and this I heard this in 1981. It's been a while. And it hasn't really improved in any real way, except for economic progress. And the idea, what is with Taiwan, you have this, it reminds me of the old Afrikaners, if anyone remembers South Africa, where the Afrikaners used to tell you, I tell you, men, these blacks, they don't like democracy, they don't understand it, you've got to be rough with them. If we have elections, man, there'll be chaos. You could say this sounds a lot like what the Chinese Communist Party is saying. They are saying effectively that, well, Chinese people have to be dealt with very harshly. And if they ever had an election, God knows what would happen. Well, you just had an election on Taiwan. And Taiwan is empirical evidence that Chinese can have consensual government. They can have the various freedoms of expression. The various freedoms that we take that are taken as an important thing, as people want to live in that kind of society. It gives a lie, ultimately, to this notion that, well, Chinese people need to be treated with a foot on their neck. And that's one of the reasons why I think it'd be particularly useful to support Taiwan.
I was actually very surprised that the Chinese Communist Party didn't send someone to Tsai's inauguration, because it was an enormous victory for Mao Zedong thought, because Mao emphasized that women should be empowered, and she is the first non-empress to lead a Chinese society ever, I believe. So in some ways, to me, she's the victory of Mao Zedong thought in a Chinese society, but I guess some saw it differently. You talk about applying meaningful economic pressure, and you mentioned sanctions. This, it seems to me, would only work if the U.S. got most of the advanced economies to go along with it. Do you think the U.S. is capable of creating a consensus who is going to get most of the EU states, Singapore, Japan, South Korea, Australia, even Taiwan for that matter, to go along? Or can the U.S. have unilateral mm-hmm. pressure that works.
I think the scale of the U.S. market and the role of the position the United States has, that if the U.S. took these measures, that it would be, I think, immensely effective. And it would potentially draw other people into it. Additionally, depending on the sanctions, and so this would be not just sanctions randomly applied, but for things like this serial IP, intellectual property theft, and cyber theft and cyber attacks, which have been going on for a good long while, that these sorts of sanctions done right, they do have a numbing effect on other countries. And so I think this would actually have a considerable effect, but one notes that there really has been no meaningful economic pressure applied to China for its failure to live up to the WTO requirements and, the accepted standards of respecting intellectual property and that sort of thing. So I think this actually is something that would be effective in terms of getting everyone to go along. That would be difficult, but it probably wouldn't be necessary.
McGann, last question. You talk about applying pressure on the ruling elite of the party. What's striking with the party, and I think it's fairly unique in world history, is clearly the leadership of the party is not what you would call pro-US in terms of international relations, foreign policy. Yet it sends all its children to the United States. Now, there's this joke that you can't have a meeting of the Central Committee during the Parents' Day at Harvard because all the members of the party are out in Cambridge, Mass. Jiang Zemin's grandson, I think, worked for Goldman Sachs. Xi Jinping's daughter just finished Harvard. Bo Xilai, of course, his dad isn't exactly a member of the establishment anymore, but went to Oxford and Columbia. How does this play? I mean, this is kind of unique because you have, as you, in your mind, a CCP that has problems with the U.S., but at the same time, not only is its children there, but often has its money, has very close, and tries to get the kids hired by American businesses. I mean, there was this Princeling issue in Hong Kong where some bankers, for some strange reason, in an Excel spreadsheet. Now, frankly, I think it was a little unfair to the banks because it's not like they do it only with Chinese princeling. I mean, I used to work in banking. It's standard. You look at who the parents are of potential employees, I mean, including in the U.S. So how does this fit in your mind, this kind of very strong connection between the ruling elite, especially through their kids, or sometimes through their own education, because now some of them have graduated and have positions in China. How does this fit?
There's a couple sort of aspects to this that strike me. And one is that this is the first time in history that I can have heard of where you have a sort of a rising great power ultimately mm-hmm. faced with a country that, an existing great power, that the rising country sees as an adversary. They've been practicing since 1989 to fight a country that has aircraft carriers. Mm-hmm. There's only one of those. And yet, at the same time, the Chinese elite and really anyone who has the wherewithal has tried at their best to get their money out of the country and ideally get a family member out of the country too and put much of this into the United States, into the rival country. I don't know that it's for necessarily love for the country, but it was explained to me once by a financial guy who said that he attributed a lot of this behavior to the lack of property rights in China. This idea that you can't be sure that your loot, that your wealth is going to be safe, so you put it somewhere safe. And the United States is a really safe place. But it's even better if you have a family member there so you can all go live there. But what that, so it is obviously a potential vulnerability. To have those kinds of resources of the people who are benefiting most from the system potentially vulnerable. And say it really is a paradox that exists. I think it is. Also, one might look at it as a futures market, where the people who benefit most from the Chinese system are not sure enough about the future to keep the bulk of their resources in the country. But I don't think that it portends the collapse of the Chinese Communist Party or China. I just don't see that happening. But it is an unusual hedging of bets that does say provides a vulnerability. One of a rough comment made by somebody not long ago was that he recommended really to get the message across to China is you take one princeling working on Wall Street and you send her home with nothing more than the clothes on her back, and that would get the message. That does sound like Chicago politics, but this administration, you think, would know something about Chicago politics. But the point there is the vulnerability posed by all of this wealth which has gone into the United States.
Well, thank you very much. I think the thing is, I mean, of course, Barack Obama was elected from Chicago, but he doesn't have the same roots there, let's say, the Daley brothers and children had. So
no, those were
I think in some ways he's a... It's a much cleaner version of Chicago than...
Well, he didn't have enough time.
No, I mean, with time, everybody can learn Chicago politics. But it does, does take a few generations. Questions? I'm very impressed. We know this is Friday night, and you've brought a large crowd. This is Tokyo. There are many things to do, but this is clearly the best place to be. The way the Q&A system works is... You can walk up to the mic and ask a question. If for some reason you want to be a little more discreet, you can ask a question from your seat, and then you won't be recorded and video recorded. So 1, 2, 3, and then walk to the mic if you like. Or you can ask a question from your seat, depending on what you prefer.
Thank you very much, Masahiro Sakamoto, Japan Forum on International Relations. I think 2015 is a quite important year. 2015, China established AIIB, so they use economic power very well. But at the same time, in 2015, they have a lot of economic, turmoil, stock market, as well as yuan, drop, and Chinese foreign reserves, which recorded $4 billion, now come to $1 trillion, now come to $3 trillion. So I think China has some kind of difficulty. And David Shambao, American University, talked about the demise of the Communist Party. So I wonder so this is a watershed year, that was 2015. And recently, there's a struggle between the Chinese leadership, between the Xi Jinping and some kind of Li Keqiang. So again, this is also the in Chinese journal, some people say this March, Xi Jinping should retire. This is quite extraordinary. How you see the Chinese in the internal situation? Thank you.
Thank you for the question. The Chinese economy, it's, how'd you put it? I'm still trying to figure out why anybody has ever believed Chinese economic statistics. In that system, what exactly is the upside of being an official at some level who doesn't meet or exceed the target? It's not like anyone's going to say, boy, this guy speaks truth to power, let's promote him. It's only bad things happen. So I don't know why anyone believes it except for perhaps Wall Street, who has things to sell. The Chinese economy, I think, does have some serious problems. I would note that economic activity, of which there is plenty in China, is not the same as productive economic activity. That said, I don't think this indicates that the Chinese system is going, that the Chinese Communist Party or the government is going to collapse anytime soon. I've heard one guy, like said just the other day, he said, you know, letting China into WTO probably extended the life of the Communist Party by 50 years. These kind of regimes can withstand a lot of economic turmoil. If you're willing to shoot a whole lot of people or make them disappear, it gives you an immense advantage over being, say, the President of the United States and having an economic collapse. But the point is that this sort of regime can withstand a lot of trouble, and China has, if anyone can deal with stress, and it really is the Chinese, one has to admire their ability to endure some pretty extreme misery. But what this has demonstrated is that despite what Thomas Friedman has said, that the Chinese are no better at, the Communist Party is no better at running an economy than any other people in history have been. So what does that leave them as a claim to running the place without any opposition? Well, it's the fact that they are going to restore China to its position of prestige and grandeur and respect. And that's a pretty good thing to latch on to. And you can see that China has done pretty well at that in developing its military, expanding its control, expanding the psychological influence and domination that comes with that. So I would suggest that China's economic problems simply mean that it's going to really focus on that sort of the external, the military, the defense angle. And that is a very good way to distract attention. It's really something, it's nothing new. It's a classic historic response. It reminds one a little bit of General Galtieri before the Falklands War. Their economy's bad, so let's distract some attention by grabbing the Falklands. Unfortunately, they picked Britain at the time. It was actually ruled by a man, so things didn't work out very well. But so I see that, yes, China's economy is a mess, but I don't know that that really threatens the stability of the country or even of the Communist Party. That's my way of looking at it. David Shambaugh, of course, did predict the imminent demise of the Chinese Communist Party. I don't want to be mean, but I suspect somebody cut off his travel budget to go to China. It took him a long while to get around to this. And these are extremely intelligent people, really know China, and yet they really got things wrong. I just couldn't resist picking on him because he might have known better. But I think he's wrong in predicting it's going to collapse. It's like somebody who suddenly woke up to something and tells all the people who knew this years ago that there's problems, that, you know, there's problems out here. Well, yeah, what took you so long? As far as the internal structure, the fussing or frictions within the Chinese regime, I think there are. You know, I think there's, and the people really debate how serious there are. But it's just a natural thing that there would be. Because you've got, you know, any group of people, you're going to have friction. And China is no different. And and I'm not entirely convinced that Mr. Xi is as solidly in control as some might think. But that, once again, it's really it's hard to say with any certainty other than to know so that there is friction. But how it will play out, I don't know of anyone who's actually predicted that with any certainty. There are people who can say it with certainty, but I'm not sure they've got it exactly right just yet. That's just my take on it.
Okay. I think China managed very well until last year, their economy. But last year, they failed, you see? Is that China is a good, while rising its phase, but keeping a down phase, it's not easy. So that's one thing. Other thing is they talk dispute inside the party, but it's the first time that kind of conflict emerge, especially in the journal. Thank you.
A good point. If you do consider it from the Chinese that ruled the top part, the top slice of the Communist Party, that trying to manage to maintain control of much of the Communist Party, much less the country, that can be a tricky thing to do. And there's probably a lot less certainty than sometimes it might appear. One can look at the response of the, for example, of the Chinese government to the New York Times and the Bloomberg reports a few years ago about high-level sort of the corruption and really people taking their money overseas. In the very top of the Communist Party, they really cracked down on Bloomberg and Time, or New York Times, and you only do that because you're worried. And there is, a lot of uncertainty within that regime. I think the control is not as solid as one thing. But your point is well taken. Thank you.
Yes.
Mike Verretto, an independent business consultant in Tokyo. Thank you very much. A very interesting discussion. I wanted to go back to Robert's question about a lot of Chinese studying in the U.S. and so forth. That's well known. Even as we're increasing relationships with China on the personal level, people studying at Harvard and especially high-placed people, party officials, sons and daughters study at the Ivy League and so forth, China is getting very, belligerent, bold, whatever. I mean, buzzing our naval vessels and so forth, and obviously getting quite belligerent. And when I talk to academics, I always get the sense that they think that we can sort of solve the China problem at the personal level. If we just relate with them one-on-one, if we meet the right people, if we invite them to the Ivy League and sort of hobnob with them, that things will improve. And I wondered what your opinion is, whether China is somewhat this monolithic thing that has other ideas about the way they're going and that personal relationships aren't going to change that much, or that that is an effective way of dealing with the China situation.
Well, thank you. I don't think that those kind of personal relationships are going to have much of a positive effect on the sort of Chinese behavior or the U.S. response to it. I suggest looking at the empirical evidence that this sort of connection actually improves relationships. And I would suggest that the evidence is pretty scarce. Just looking at it from the military standpoint, one hears a lot about the need to have engagement, that the more this mil-to-mil, the military-to-military connection, if we do that, then they'll become our friends. We'll work things out. It presumes that they want to work things out and that things aren't going pretty well from their perspective already. The evidence isn't there. I would cite the 1930s when all the major powers attended each other's exercises and training operations. This is a good one. In 1935, Ernst Udet, who was a German Luftwaffe pilot, an ace from World War I, he visited America. The Marine Corps took him on a flight in a Marine Corps dive bombers. The Nazis didn't seem to get much nicer, but they learned something about dive bombers in the sort of a blitzkrieg offensive. I just don't see the evidence of that. Once again, it presumes that the other side wants to do anything differently, and I would suggest that China, from China's perspective, I think they're doing very well, actually. They look at what they've achieved. It's a powerful economy now, the political influence that they certainly didn't have a long time ago. They've got a military which is pretty good, and they've been able to really, they're within a hair's breadth of having physical domination over a sea half again as big as the Mediterranean. So I'm not convinced that the relationships have that much of an effect.
Conversely then, is there any downside to inviting, so many people and granting them access to our technology and thoughts and money and so forth, or what,
I think the access to technology, and particularly businesses that do not protect their intellectual property effectively, they're committing suicide. I've actually used to work for a company that did that. They committed it some other ways, but that was part of it. That is a huge risk. I think having Chinese people come to live in America, study in America, see anything. I don't see a problem with that. But certainly in the access to technology, And that sort of thing, that is a huge risk. And that has been, this is known to be part of China's strategy, is to develop by, what do they call it, leaping over stages or such like. And the idea is to use all overseas Chinese as potential resources for getting technology, information that can be used to enhance or to make China stronger to Chinese benefit. And it's just one case after another of industrial espionage where information is stolen. That's where I think the risk is. To me, at least one of the bigger risks is that. There was a story, this was about the mid-90s, and it was quoted to me, and it was the head of one of the Hughes groups, the Hughes aircraft electronics groups, I forget which one, and he was asked if he minded giving, revealing technology to China. He goes, no, because we'll always be ahead of them. And that was a very American, a very sort of stupid way to look at it. And the Greeks could have told you back when the Greeks mattered that when you have hubris, that the goddess Nemesis is not far along. And it really has underestimated, I would say, the industriousness and the ingenuity, aggressiveness of the Chinese, and that is done to one's peril. You know, it is really what they have done. I think you've got to be pretty impressed with. You know, I wish they hadn't done it so well, but one should be impressed with that. But but in terms of people wanting to come to universities, you know, obviously that tends to get abused, but not because it in certain ways. But it, you know. But it isn't really, I don't think it's a huge threat but from the business end, that's where hanging on to your technology is key. And that does require keeping an eye and being careful about hiring Chinese and how you do business, just to be on the safe side. So.
Good evening. My name is Alejandro from the Philippines. At about late April, there's been reports in the Wall Street Journal that Washington changed the planned FONOPS, Freedom of Navigation Operations, changed it to flyovers over Scarborough Shoal. And the way the articles were written, it's like it was made intentionally vague, as if there was some like complex signaling that's being exchanged between China, Philippines, and the US. Can you give us more color on what are the dynamics during that incident?
I remember the period you're talking about and the various things that were done. I've not tried to parse the significance of what's being done. You get sort of lost in the specifics. I take some credit for coining half the phrase after one of the early U.S. Movements through the Spratlys. I referred to it as the right. We demonstrated the right of incoherent passage. There may be a clear explanation for this, but you have to ask how was it interpreted? How was it seen? It's kind of puzzling exactly what the United States is trying to do. But I think it is a good faith effort to demonstrate that we will be in that area and that we're going to operate there. But sometimes by pulling back a bit from what you do, we might see this as a sign of goodwill, a goodwill gesture. The other side just sees as, well, that's all you're going to do? They won't be as impressed. If it was the Canadians, they might appreciate it, but I'm not sure the Chinese would. What I think is these operations in the South China Sea are very important to do it, to establish the permanent presence there, that we will be there. But I think we need to do them in a less restrained fashion. And you certainly always, you have to really keep this up on a regular basis. Otherwise, the other side just adjusts to it. And I would compare this to, if anyone go to New York City back before Rudy Giuliani was the mayor? Okay. No, you would know then. You were probably the problem. But but if you went to Times Square, you know, remember Times Square used to be like the crappiest place on the planet, if not the universe. You know, it was just full of criminals. You know, these the cups. You know, the game where you guess which pee the cup is in, and just criminals and thieves, etc. Now, the NYPD, the New York police, anytime they wanted, they could send a squad car, a police car, through Times Square, and they would park the human flotsam, and they could go through. And they controlled that little bit that they were in for that little time, and then it would close up. And that's what the U.S., the FONOPs in the South China Sea remind me of. You can send a U.S. ship and you can send aircraft through, and then they're gone. And then it closes up, and it's China that has control. And you also find that you'll probably have regularly Chinese ships will accompany U.S. ships going through the area. And so it points out the limitations on relying too much on that specific act. But I'm always reminded of Times Square, and then Giuliani cleaned it up, and you would actually want to go there. But all they could do was temporarily part the troublemakers and dominate only that part that they were on. And that is one of the concerns that, it's one of the reasons I have some, I don't count too much on the importance of those operations, although if you don't do those operations, that you might as well just give up right now. We really do have to make that effort.
But besides the fact there were some issues with Giuliani's policing methods, at least the compatibility with the U.S. Constitution, what would you propose? What is the kind of Giuliani method in the South China Sea?
It needs to be part of a larger strategy. I would suggest that the South China Sea problem is not going to be solved in the South China Sea, but rather by simultaneously doing other things, such as getting the U.S.-Japan linkage really strong, bringing in some other countries in the region, upgrading their militaries to the point that they can operate with us, enforce the Taiwan Relation Act, enforce World Trade Organization requirements, the economic pressure, actually having a real strategic communications plan and carry it out. I would suggest that the public affairs officials of DOD, Department of State, and National Security Council, each expressing in unison their grave concern, is not exactly a strategic communications plan. Additionally, the corruption angle is something that the leadership is vulnerable to. But it has to be, but so what you have is the military activities in the South China Sea are just one part of a larger plan, a larger effort, which really all it does is hold China in place. China is not, I don't think they're going to leave those islands anytime soon. There's no reason why they would. There's not going to be rolled back by military force or by being talked out of it. They're there, but you can at least keep them from getting much farther. I would also note that one angle that should be considered is the idea that one here, that A2AD, this anti-access area denial idea, which the one hears a lot about, that China has A2AD as if, you know, that's the end of the game. But it works both ways. And the geography of that terrain is such that very easily you could lock it up from Kagoshima over to the Andaman Islands and make it so, yeah, China can, if they do, they'll probably will have physical domination of this cow's tongue, part of it, but try going much further. And that's is something to keep in mind, and that would be part of the scheme if you have Vietnam, Indonesia, and some other countries which do have, say, anti-ship missiles, and the other things that you can do as part of an A2AD scheme, is it works both ways. A fellow named Tom Hammes, or T.X. Hammes, a retired Marine colonel, has some very interesting ideas on actually it amounts to a strategic defense within the first island chain, and he's got some good ideas. So there are things that can be done. But the idea of rolling back the Chinese from those islands, I just don't see that happening. They've got them, and I don't think they're going to go anywhere. But going much further can be a problem for them if say, if the countries where consensual government mostly is respected, if they actually do what is necessary.
Yes? Jing?
Thank you for the talk, sir. My name is Ivy. I'm a student of New York University. I'm currently interning in this institute. I have two questions. My first question is on the end goal of this policy initiative that you propose. Do you consider the end goal of being tough on China to be a military deterrence against China in the South China Sea? Because it seems that looking back to the history, whenever the United States, let's say, be more assertive against China, it only provokes a counterbalancing act from China. China has the justification or the every reason to send its navies near the Senkaku Island. So why do you think that being tough on China is a better option than, say, sending the territory dispute to international jurisdiction or having diplomatic means? First question. My second question is on policy priority. So to what extent do you think that the importance of South China Sea triumphs over the common interest between the United States and China? For example, the importance of combating climate change, the importance of combating terrorism in East Asia as well as overall. So what do you think that the Chinese people or Chinese government will respond to United States' sense of being tough on China? And why do you think this is in the interest of the United States? Thank you for your
The end goal ultimately is to have China play by the rules that the civilized world community has taken centuries to try and figure out and try to, however imperfectly, to implement, particularly that, once again, the sanctity of borders and boundaries, international boundaries, the peaceful resolution of disputes, the idea that big countries don't take what they want from little countries, the idea that countries that international law, such as it is, they follow it, even when it isn't in their what they would like to think their benefit. They also the ideas of individual freedoms that that we take as an important thing. That these are things that are the end goal. It is the I would suggest look to Taiwan if one wants to see what the end goal might be for China. The idea that and the idea that you call it that by standing up, or actually defending our and our partners, our like-minded countries' interests, is provoking China. That's an argument that goes back to Bible days. It's an old argument, and the idea is, well, if you stand up for yourselves, you provoke the person. And a lot of these argument these ideas that we. I think that apply in this case. Most we learned some of them at about the age of five in the schoolyard playground. When you have a bully who wants your stuff, you can either give it to him and hope that he's happy, or you can stand up for yourselves. And if I'd say history in the last century taught us anything, it's when the free countries actually do stand up to defend themselves, good things happen. And when they don't, bad things happen. In the 30s, actually, the idea of appeasement, which is what you've partly described here, was considered what the in crowd, the smart people, understood. And this was the way to treat Germany, was to just understand their fears, deal with them, show them you're not a threat, extend the open hand of friendship, and that then the things will work out. Well, that didn't really work that very well. Jimmy Carter actually tried it with the Russians when he first took over, and that lasted until they went into Afghanistan, and he learned his lesson. But the idea of using legal methods, I think we'll find in short order, and China's already said that they don't care what the ruling is in the South China Sea. They're not going to follow it. And that China, like the old Soviet Union, doesn't give two hoots about international law when it is to China's perceived disadvantage. Diplomacy, that may not work so well. It's, one wonders when Mr. Putin is going to get out of Crimea, which maybe never. Unfortunately, legal methods, diplomatic methods don't work, and that's in this case, but that is where we would like to get, ultimately, to where we could use those more effectively. As for the common interests between China and the United States, I think these may be overstated. I think Chinese cooperation on you know, climate change to the extent it is really a big interest. I'm not sure their cooperation is going to be all that useful, given that they are, you know, that pollution really works pretty well under control in China right now, it appears. I'm obviously not serious, but I don't see that keeping terrorists at bay, I'm not sure that's really a huge strategic problem. I would say these ideas of, once again, freedom of the commons, freedom of the high seas, this is something that is more important and something that is worth standing up for, and these other issues that I described earlier. But what you described is an argument which is often made, is that if we are tough or if we stand up for ourselves, we are thereby provoking the other side. And it applies not just to China. It applies in a lot of cases, and there's many historic examples. But I would see that actually standing up is going to get us farther. And if you've done business with China, there is no advantage to be gained by appearing to be weak or to make preemptive concessions. You might as well just give up at that point. And that's a peculiarity to doing business, I was to say, in Asia, and particularly with China. It works well with the British or the Canadians or so. They appreciate that sort of thing, just as Americans do. If somebody's nice to us, we're nice to them back. We don't see that as a sign of weakness to be capitalized on. So that would be my my comments on the questions and your points.
Let me follow up on your answer. You use kind of two historical analogies. It was 1930s, appeasement, and dealing with the Soviets. The difference of it, to me, would seem that in the 1930s, of course, we all know it ended pretty badly. And it's hard to see how it could not have ended that way, because the raison d'etre of the fascist regimes in Italy and in Germany was to wage war. I mean, once they were in power, it had to end up that way. The question was, how would the Allies find a way to win at the lowest cost possible? In the Soviet case, it was possible to avoid, well, there were conflicts, obviously there was the Korean War and directly the Vietnam War, but it was possible basically to avoid a class A confrontation until the regime was transformed. So what is your analogy? Is it the 1930s or is it handling the Soviets? Because if one uses the 1930s, one is basically assuming that Beijing wants war, because that's what the 1930s regimes wanted. If we're using the Soviet one, it's, yeah, they're not opposed to using force, but no one is, but they're reasonable, and if the cost is too high, they will remain peaceful, which is how, whether it's Stalin or softer men who followed him, behaved. So what's your analogy?
I think that it's sort of in between, but it'd be closer to the Soviet one. And I would suggest this is that you could probably spend an afternoon debating it. I would suggest that in the 30s, it was possible to avoid the kind of war that followed. And even then, it's to say debatable. But I would say the Soviet is the closer example, because I think there is a fair distinction to be made between, say, this national socialist ideology and what you have in China. So I think that would be the better thing. But I think that the idea is that to show China that there's more to be had by following the rules, and that the other side will not back down, and that there are risks to behaving as they are. And say more to be had to actually, I think that is possible. But you do have to be tough and actually show that you won't be bullied down.
You mentioned in your article that you're dealing with what you call a 45-year-old failed social science experiment, which I guess should tell those who are studying the social sciences that it's really a bad idea to do an experiment that lasts 45 years, because you're not going to get tenured on it. You'll be a little old. But I think if you look at policy, at least since the end of the Cold War, you look at Clinton, Bush 43, Obama, they've had very similar policies towards China. I mean, there's really no great difference as opposed to, say, their policies in places like Iraq. Who do you think in the US advocates the sort of policy correction that you call for?
Lily, but he died a few years ago. The day he died, all the charlatans breathed easier. That's I couldn't resist. That was just waiting to come out.
I worked in D.C. I know charlatans are in the majority.
Okay, well, there are a few, but what you're seeing now, interestingly, in the United States, I would say within maybe the last year and a half, there actually has been something of a shift to a wider recognition that this lab experiment hasn't worked. And you're finally starting to see it. Actually, I would call it the business community writ large. You know, all these people who thought for many years that they were going to sell one of something to every Chinaman, they're finally realizing there isn't that much money to be made in China under the rules, under the situation as it currently exists. And there is a feeling that people are tired of being fleeced, of the intellectual property theft, turning on a computer in China and having everything disappear. There is a sense, and it used to be, it was very different before that, where the business community writ large in the United States wanted to do anything but upset China. And there's a change in that area. And also, I think within the political world, within officialdom, I think there is more of a recognition that, you know, there's a problem with China, and it requires a stricter, sort of a different approach. So I think actually there is finally a recognition after 45 years, and I was actually around for the beginning, and you probably were too. But a few of us, you know, I actually remember this, and when, you know, the Carter administration, when they were giving, you know, advanced weaponry to the Russians, to the Chinese, as a way to balance off the against the Soviets, and then the Reagan administration gave them things, which even I figured out, well, maybe we shouldn't be doing this, but nobody listens to me. But it is finally, I think in the US, there is something of a shift that's taken place. It remains to be seen how far it goes, but it's different than it was just a couple years ago. And you could have practically had your Pentagon building pass canceled about 10 years ago if you had suggested China was anything other than a friend and a responsible stakeholder. Things have changed since then. So,
Siegfried Niedl, correspondent for Austrian newspaper Der Standard. I think there is a problem that China wants to win the South China Sea without military force. And I think that America doesn't have really an answer for this way to solve the problem, and the other countries all too small to defend against a big number of coast guard ships and fish trawler from China. They cannot defend against it, but U.S. cannot help them with military force because China wants to hold the conflict as a non-military conflict, and it would put the conflict on a very different level. So which way can this problem be solved?
We could solve if America just concedes and says, well, we lost. That hopefully won't happen. But your point is very well taken, sir. I don't think there is a military solution to these islands or the South China Sea issue. One sometimes hears U.S. officials and even senior military officers say, well, we could take those islands, we could destroy them in minutes if we had to. Well, that's true, but I don't think we're ever going to do that, given all the ramifications which would come of actually firing a shot. So the fact that these may not be defensible in an actual shooting war, I would suggest is actually irrelevant. I think that China has done a very good job of, during what is called phase zero, before sort of a conflict starts, of positioning themselves in certain places, in certain ways, with certain equipment and weapons, and positioning themselves to put the opposition into a way they can't move, or that if they could, it's not worth the cost. nobody, they're just not going to do it. And it's a very, you know, say you, I admire, you know, what the Chinese have accomplished. I think you have to give them credit for sizing up the opposition very well. So I think, unfortunately, that it is possible that, you know, you could these islands are not going to be resolved. That is not going to be resolved militarily, I don't think. So I think the statement that, well, they can't defend them, well, they're not going to have to, I don't think, because nobody is going to start a war over those rocks. In terms of what the other countries can do, I think you're right that individually they would get eaten one by one. They would have a hard time. Just being an American, one hesitates to write off the Vietnamese. But that said, and given what weaponry is today, where particularly the development of things, certain anti-aircraft systems, anti-ship missiles, smart sea mines, even a country like Vietnam could give China all it wants to, more than it wants to handle. And that this is where technological advances have actually improved exponentially the ability of a smaller country to make life so miserable for anybody who tries to cause them trouble. That does have a potential effect. But I think without the continued presence of the United States in the region and its demonstrated willingness and commitment and ability to defend its interest and the interests, once again, of the other countries which don't want to fall under Han Chinese domination, without that U.S. presence, it'd be very tough for the rest of the nation that's to get together. I heard this anecdote, which I remembered, was a few years ago, I think it was after the Scarborough Shoals incident, I was speaking at an event, and one of the other speakers was a former, very senior Philippine official, and I heard him say, after a presentation on the Scarborough Shoals and what had happened, I heard him say to himself, or to nobody in particular, he said, there's nothing we can do. And he probably got it right, you know, but it showed that, once again, it's an anecdote, but it gives you a sense of the difficulties of these smaller countries actually defending their interests. And once again, the fundamental role of the United States, and I would suggest the United States linked up with Japan, is an even more powerful thing operationally, politically, militarily, and psychologically.
Makoto Hanjo, I'm a businessman. in the coalition of the willing, sort of, it's on. Yeah, speak up. Okay. In the coalition of the willing formula that you were formulating, I was wondering what your assessment was about Korea, because Korea right now, many people would say, well, they have two minds. I mean, they have a pro-China sort of a element, and then they have a, well, we still want to be with America sort of a element, and it seemed from the outside, it seems to be a dichotomy within Korea, which hasn't necessarily worked itself out completely. And I was wondering what your assessment was right now.
You know, the Irish of Asia. So I think the Koreans. You've described it very well. I think I would tend to see the Koreans as not somebody to toy with. I think that they will not be China's lapdogs, and they won't be anybody's. There's a point at which China can only do so much with Korea. Hedging their bets isn't quite the right word. They just don't feel like being dominated by anyone, and they are willing to bite back. I don't see one of the challenges or the aspects of Korea that's worth mentioning is they have never really exerted themselves off the peninsula very much. Yes, they get out a bit, but not as much as they've had planned to do or talking about doing 15 years ago. that still there's sort of an internal look and focus towards the peninsula. The recent relative improvements in the relationship with the Japanese, it's a positive sign, but still that's one, you know, would need to wait a much longer time to reach a final decision on how well that, how that turns out. Within Korea itself, there is an, as I understand it, a substantial sort of a part of the ruling class, or whatever you, the chattering class, which is pretty much, which does favor a sort of a more accommodating stance towards China, sees its interests there, just as within Nagatacho, you'll find a lot of people who think that as well. So it is a, there's different ways to look at it, but I think that ultimately Korea is going to defend its interests, as we've seen when they how they deal with Chinese fishing boats that that get into their territory. But there's limits to how much they can do, and so it's hard to say with any certainty. But it, other than that, it is not going to go into China's camp. And it's probably not going to go into anyone else's camp, but it'll sort of be somewhere in the middle. That's
Hiroshi Meguro, and I used to be a research fellow at the Institute of Okinawan Studies at the Hosei University, and I'm writing about Okinawa base issues for, mainly base issues for Huffington Post, Japan. And I'd like to go back to the South China Sea issue, and you talked about the relations between ASEAN countries and China, and quite difficult for ASEAN countries to deal with China. But I heard that some people in the Philippines and Malaysia are trying to coordinate, you know, because they share the problems. But Brunei is dropping out, unfortunately, and Malaysia is quite hesitant. But at least, for instance, the Philippines, and if Philippines and Vietnam work together, how to deal with the China, and then if they are successful, and they might be able to involve other countries, including, well, for instance, Malaysia. And do you think that it's a kind of plausible or practical scenario? Thank you.
I think it's not implausible. I think you can actually create a reasonable network, sort of maybe a web of connections between the Southeast Asian, some of the Southeast Asian nations, the ones you've described, for example, say Indonesia, Philippines, Vietnam, Malaysia, possibly Singapore. You can even work the Australians in there if you want. So it is possible, but there's limits to how far and how effective it can be. But I think that you can, by appropriately upgrading these militaries with certain capabilities, certain hardware, and then ideally have them start doing more with each other, and then have the U.S. into the mix, that can be potentially a very effective thing. And if looked at from China's perspective, where they would prefer to deal with the countries one-to-one, just because it's, you're going to swallow them up. But is any sort of a reasonable network between the Southeast Asian or Asian countries that, that is some. It's a plus. It's not enough by itself, but it would be a nice addition compared to the customary sort of idea of the U.S. being the ones who bilaterally have these relationships, and somehow this keeps stability. But it is time that, I think it is possible with the right effort, that you could have some of these nations actually do more and be better at what they do. And that would give, if you put yourself in the position of a Chinese strategist, a Chinese planner, it makes things much more complicated when you're dealing with competent, capable adversaries who can actually work together with each other. And then you overlay the Americans, the Japanese, the Australians onto that. and it gets to be very different. And there's also always a political angle to military relationships. And the better the military relationship, the stronger the political relationship. And that also has a sort of a deterring effect, one might say.
Hi. Me? Oh, okay, thank you. My name is Michi Mimuranoshi, Professor of International Politics at Gakushin University. I have a few questions. The first is, do you think that the situation of the East China Sea and the situation of the South China Sea are totally different from each other? In other words, Japan occupies, fortunately, the Senkaku Daoyu area, and China occupies most part of the South China Sea. But do you think that on the one hand, the United States pledges that it is going to stand for the side of Japan in the case of conflict, and can the United States refuse to do likewise in the case of South China Sea? It may affect the credibility of the US foreign policy. The second question related to that is that, do you think that there is no, absolutely no possibility that the United States might be involved in war with China on concerning the South China Sea? I think Vietnam have imported submarines from Russia, and the US lifted the arms embargo to Vietnam, and there might happen some small military clashes between Philippines, Vietnam, and on the one hand, and China. And is it possible that the United States can be standing aside, can be quiet? The third question, and the final question is that, given the serious problems now, what kind of perception do you think that the United States had in the 1970s when the United States started normalizing relations with China? Do you think that the United States had any kind of scenario that the current situation might happen in the future at that time? And so that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The East China Sea, South China Sea, the situations are they're different in certain respects, and you cited them. The one, Japan does has a presence in the East China Sea. I wish they had the presence sooner, and it would have avoided a lot of the problems. But they are more of a presence in other parts of the Nansei Shoto, but they waited too long. South China Sea, obviously, it is very different. I think the common aspect here is that China has said that South China Sea is Chinese, and that they've been very clear. The statements about East China Sea, if you've listened for them, they've said it in their own way, and they've said what they think and ultimately what they're going to do. And that is a common aspect. And you do see in Chinese behavior, it tends to bounce from one place to another, like focus on South China Sea, then give the East China Sea some attention, and even Yellow Sea gets some. But they tend to bounce back and forth, but eventually all areas will get their, they'll get their full attention. Would the United States intervene in either place? I don't know. I do know that Mr. Obama has said clearly that the Americans will back Japan on the Senkaku's issue. And I think he really, when he was out here a year or two ago, and he said, made that statement in Tokyo that he would back, the United States would back Japan, that was very good. But then when he went down to the Philippines and said something like that, that America was backing the Philippines, I think that really surprised the Chinese. I think it just shocked them that America would actually back the Philippines. Years ago, I remember meeting at dinner with a Chinese diplomat. And he, after we'd finished the main course, he pulls out a map of the Nansei Shoto, a very detailed map, and he's asking me these questions. And most of the questions centered on, would America really defend the dwarfs? I mean, really defend the Japanese? And yeah, you know, this was Bush was president then, so you kind of take on the persona of a Texan. And yeah, and I think he just couldn't believe that America would back these, the Oni, you know, these people. Well, you know, we will sometimes. You never quite know what America's going to do. And a lot of people have, I think, guessed wrong and paid for it. The Article 5 actually is something worth mentioning on this point, because there is apparently, within recent living memory, I told a Japanese foreign affairs official that I was with, I told him, you know, I wouldn't be so sure that the United States is going to back you, if you, particularly if you don't spend more money on defense, if you don't, you know, make it a more balanced relationship. And all he said was, no, you don't know what you're talking about. Anpo Joyaku. And he almost stuck out his tongue at me. And the idea, he thought, well, we have a treaty, and he thought it was like a contract that required America to go die for Japan. Like a lot of foreign affairs guys, he didn't understand America or Americans very well. But if you read Article 5, and you don't have to be a lawyer to see that it really doesn't require anyone to do anything other than talk. And that's pretty easy. And one could imagine a scenario, say, where China just lands fishermen on the Senkakus and tells Japan, okay, you touch them and see what happens. And, you know, maybe America would get involved, maybe they wouldn't. One can almost hear Senator Kerry talking, well, we believe that negotiation is the way to solve these problems. And you can see, and which means you're on your own, guys. And you can see Japan just going berserk. But what that is a scenario. It's not to say that it will happen or could happen. We could be here all week discussing scenarios. But the point is that Article 5, I do encourage people to read it and see what it actually does or doesn't require somebody to do. But very, you know, and I'd say that a promise by the United States that it will do something is generally no guarantee it'll do anything, but I would not underestimate the willingness of the Americans to stand up for some of these principles that I mentioned. As for the possibility of war in Southeast Asia, you know, starting from some small thing and getting into a big thing, who knows? I would suggest that most wars that have ever happened have kind of nobody really predicted them. There's usually one guy who afterwards said, well, I predicted it. And that's his one shot at fame in his entire life. But it's very hard to, you know, to predict how things will turn out. But one really can't underestimate, you know, just one shot. And that has a way of changing perceptions, behaviors, and things that people thought impossible. Suddenly they start to look at things very differently. So it is definitely a situation to take very seriously, to my way of thinking.
So I just wanted to make a comment, because something you were talking about building, shifting in Southeast Asia from hubs and spokes construct to linking more of the bilateral relationships together. And I just want to take a second to talk about some things that happened just the last few months that I've been watching very carefully. You know, are they game changing? Are they shifting from one construct to the other overnight? Absolutely not. But there has been a real movement in the direction you're talking about. Just to mention a few things, a couple months ago, there was the first ever trilateral maritime planning meeting between the Japanese, the United States, and the Philippines. That took place in the Philippines to talk about these very issues you're suggesting. Shortly thereafter, the 7th Fleet Commander hosted the second ever roundtable between Southeast Asian fleet commanders to talk about these very issues and build relationships. And then just last week was the first ever trilateral U.S. Malaysia Philippines maritime exercise. And the other thing I want to say is, I think almost everything you just said when you were talking about Article 5 and U.S. commitment to Japan was correct, but you wandered around a lot of areas in that answer, and might have come across like the United States was less committed to Japan than I certainly believe the United States is. Are there questions? Is it a contract? There are questions. It's not a contract enforceable by any court of the law. But I think it's a pretty solid commitment.
That could be. You know, John's done more than any human probably in Tokyo or in Japan to actually improve the security architecture in Southeast Asia. As for the certainty that we'll be with Japan in every situation, I'm not so sure. You know, I like to think so, and I think that Japan should count on us, but you know, I'm just not entirely sure, particularly once Walmart's lobbyists trot up to Capitol Hill telling us to just stay neutral. You know, I'm being a little funny, but I'd like to think so, and I hope so. So.
Murakami-sensei, we have time for, we'll put Murakami-sensei and Alban together. So just ask a quick question and we'll get a quick answer. So you and then Alban and then, you're next, Alban, too, after, but we'll ask both, you ask your questions and then Grant will answer both of them at the same time.
Okay.
And then we are out of question time.
So I can?
Yes.
Murakami, a journalist. Right now, I think the military power difference between the United States and China is overwhelming, like 10 to 1 or even more in favor of the United States. The way the U.S. planned everything and all the strategic nuclear subs with all these missiles that has been reduced with the Russian side is now pretty much not deployed, actually, but I think ready to crash that country, just like nothing. What I think is what the U.S. and Japan as well, the Japanese are going to decline as we go by with the older population and everything. We don't even have enough young men to fill the quota of the Japanese armed forces.
From there not enough women in the SDF as a problem?
But what I'm saying is come 2050, when the Chinese GDP catches up the U.S. or even more. And then if you start looking at the trade figures between Vietnam and China, Philippine China, Indonesia and China, U.S. is not going to be a match because of geographical propinquity. Obviously, the Chinese and the Southeastern Asians are much more at advantage in their trade and making money. And people are more interested in the easy life and everything. So before you know it, these countries are going to start having a difficulty whether they're going to have a military power assisted by the U.S. and still rich enough Japan and the freedom or the daily life, much more trade and prosperous business. And not only that, these business worlds in the Philippines, a lot of them are Chinese origin. Indonesia, the economy is in the Chinese-oriented people, Indonesians. And Vietnam, okay. Thailand.
What's your question?
My question is, I think it's going to be very, very difficult in the long run, 30 years from now, to cope against China. And China would realize that it's much more effective to work on the economic field rather than in the military.
Okay. And Alban, a brief question, and then we'll get an answer.
Alban, per internet, I guess. I just, you've addressed a lot in this talk of strategy issues, to put it very simply. The question is actually quite kind of related. The checkbook is often mightier than this word. What to do in kind of economic war, well, what would be the leverages of the US in kind of an economic war with China? Because I see many leverages the Chinese will have over the US, especially the increasing, growing part of the U.S. debt that is actually owned by China. But I don't see the opposite. I don't see quite see the, what the U.S. will have as a leverage, as an economic leverage in China in case that you will need to, in case the conflict was escalated, you will need an economic leverage.
Okay.
The economic leverage, the Chinese holdings of U.S. debt is not the advantage one thinks it is. I can go into that, but it's very interesting, but it's not. In terms of economic leverage, some Chinese economic success depends on this export machine, cheap manufacturing and exports. Interrupt that, and you've got some huge problems. the CCP having to deal with 100 million, 200 million unemployed people. That's a problem, especially when they know that the top elite has all got houses in Vancouver and New York City. So there's immense economic leverage that the United States has, because the Chinese success is based on this export-driven economy. But it is a point that deserves careful study, and it's not. And so the question is well taken. The previous questions, in terms of the U.S. being greatly overmatching the Chinese militarily, all I can say is don't bet on it. Things have happened, and the Chinese have gotten pretty good, and they only need to be good enough to do a certain thing in a certain place at a certain time. Into things like space, cyber, anti-satellite technology, pretty good. Their submarines are getting better. In a lot of ways, they have, and their missiles go farther than ours, some of them. In sporting terms, we spotted them a lot of runs that we probably shouldn't have. So I wouldn't be too certain of that. As for the PRC's economy growing to, gradually take over the whole, to be the top one in the world, I remember the 80s when, the only solution for, the only bright future was if you learn Japanese and learned how to speak to our Japanese masters once the Japanese economy took over the, that was the only thing. The Japanese economy overwhelmed everything. I'm not convinced the Chinese will. Once again, I've noted, Chinese statistics are what they are, and I don't think they're very reliable. There's activity, but in terms of productive activity, I'm not sure of that. And these extrapolations over time are very difficult. For example, it's always dangerous to rely on. I wake up in the morning, and it's like 60 degrees, and then by 10 o'clock, it's 65. So by 4 o'clock, I should be cooked like a hot dog, if you extrapolate. And I think that by 2050, you're going to find that I think China's going to have some problems, especially there after this wonderful one-child policy. That is going to just drop off the cliff. There may even be more Japanese than Chinese at that point. I'm being a little funny, but they've got problems to deal with. So it's very hard to... I'm skeptical of the notion of Chinese economic dominance, but I do think that, unfortunately, that is going to transfer into a more aggressive, militarily assertive, and a pretty capable force to have to deal with, would be my sense of it. And I don't have my glasses, and I can't read what I wrote about the last part. But your points are well, it's all well taken. And I would stress that, I have some ideas about things, and I think they're in the ballpark, but I'm not the last word on these things. One never quite knows. Fortunately, 25 years to 2050 is a long time. One remembers thousand-year Reichs that didn't last quite that long. But it's hard to predict how long a system or a regime will keep going. This was really interesting, so I appreciate the chance.
Thank you very much. At one point, I thought you had served in the Marines in the middle of the summer in Iraq when you said 60 degrees, and I realized you were talking about Fahrenheit, right?
That's the only standard to
Okay, no, because I thought, I know we have global warming, but Tokyo at 60 degrees, that's really bad. That's when they even start the air conditioning. I think that's how it works. Interesting you mentioned Vancouver, because there's an article in the New York Times, there's a Lamborghini club for young Chinese in their 20s. And there was an article about one who was complaining that I think her daddy wasn't giving her enough for two cars. But thanks very much. I think it's been a really good discussion. I'd like to thank everybody for participating. We have two poetry readings coming. They're on our website. You shouldn't think of us as just kind of a military intellectual complex. And then on July 1st, we have a session on the Tokyo Olympics. And I think we will conclude the year with a session on Fukushima. And then we'll take a break from mid to late July to September. But again, thank you all for coming. And first and foremost, thanks to Grant. Thank you. It's always great to have you. We hope you'll come back again. Again, don't forget your business cards and your money, but if the choice is between one, we'd rather have your money, frankly.